started. That was a little abstract. What we're going to, hard to follow. What we're going to do next is even more so. So, not really good news there for you, but okay. So, we're talking about Robert Nozick. And then we have another one topic at the end of class, which will be fun. So hopefully we won't spend too much time on Robert Nozick. Robert Nozick wasn't a terribly influential philosopher, but he sort of always gets taught along with John Rawls because he was a philosopher at Harvard University at the time John Rawls was at Harvard. John Rawls published his book that we talked about, which was called A Theory of Justice. And Robert Nozick was there at the same university, same philosophy department. He did not like John Rawls or his book at all, so he wrote this book as a direct response to Rawls. So Robert Nozick's book is called Anarchy, State, and Utopia. So Nozick is trying to... anarchy is, of course, state of nature, right? And what kind of state can we justify from the state of nature? So the basic idea of Robert Nozick is that, well, basic claims, basic idea, only a minimal state is justified. Now, we don't have time to go into why exactly this is. But by a minimal state, he's obviously talking about, it's similar, he's just coming at it from a different direction, right? He's basically saying what Milton Friedman was saying is, look, the government only has two legitimate functions, you know, protecting the citizens, minimal. Only a minimal state is justified. So he's saying the same thing as Robert Nozick, or sorry, as Milton Friedman was, that, you know, look, the state only has these very narrow functions that are appropriate. But he's coming at it from a social contract. So by minimal, he means, you know, essentially just protection. One of the terms he uses is a night watchman state. So this is a state that essentially ensures law and order and enforces the basic things needed to run business, like enforcing contracts and patents and things like that. But the government really doesn't do anything else. And that's his basic idea. He claims to be inspired by Kant, so he draws from Kant. And how does he draw from Kant? He does that by Kant's principle of not using other people as a means to an end. So that's one sort of his basic idea. And in short, he thinks that taxing rich people to help poor uses the rich people as a means to an end. So that's, he claims to be drawing from Kant, which I think is just sort of interesting. Rawls is also drawing from Kant. They come to completely different conclusions. So again, what's the right, they're essentially arguing what's the right interpretation of these earlier philosophers. He thinks that when we tax rich people, we tax rich people to help the poor. We're using the rich people. Okay. It's a social contract theory. So he starts in the state of nature, and he thinks about, well, what kind of state can you build up from the state of nature? So it's very much Hobbesian in that sense. He's starting from the state of nature, and he's thinking, what would people agree to? So it's a kind of social contract theory built up in that way. Sort of uses Hobbesian sort of reasoning. talked about justified, he means in terms of Hobbesian reasoning. Hobbesian reasoning to think about what people would agree to. And essentially, the way what he imagines this process being like is he imagines a bunch of people in a state of nature. So what would people agree to? So his sort of Hobbesian state of nature, he says, so we start in the state of nature. The way he imagines it, that's sort of step one. He goes through this process of thinking about how what would happen is in a state of nature you'd end up with, so the idea of a government, right, so step three, government that enforces law and order, if you imagine step four being, so he thinks there's two things. One is he thinks there's a missing step, which we'll get to in a second. And then if you imagine a government that provides extensive services, this is, of course, simplifying everything he says greatly. He says we wouldn't get to this final step. That's his first point. This final step we wouldn't get to. So this is as far as we'd go, a minimal government, a government that enforces law and order. And he, there's a middle step in which there would be protective agencies, I think is what he calls them. This is kind of like privatized police services. So you can imagine us, like we're the people in society. Well, what would we do if we were in a state of nature, right? And we're all fighting and killing each other. Well, you'd probably start to make alliances with people, right? So the first step wouldn't be, you know, get everyone together in a group. What you'd end up doing is maybe, you know, I'm good friends with Jinman, and we say, okay, we make a little agreement that we're not going to kill each other or take each other's stuff, and we're going to kind of help each other survive. And then maybe Mitchell wants to join our group, and we say, okay. And then, like, on the other side of the island, in the back, you know, a few people joining a group. And then, so you get these different groups, these little tribes that would form, and then eventually, from those tribes, it would make sense for people to want to come together and get rid of the tribes, because the tribes still wouldn't get rid of fighting. So you get to this sort of universal government, a state that would enforce law and order, laws for equally for everyone. But you wouldn't, according to Nozick, you wouldn't get to this idea of government that provides extensive services. His arguments, honestly, are sort of not entirely, he has a lot of different arguments, and that's why he can't summarize them all for this idea. He has a number of different arguments, so I'm not sure you guys are disappointed, we're not going to get into them, but that's ultimately what he thinks, is you don't get to this last step. You don't get the egalitarian kind of government. What we'll do is we'll talk about, well, we'll go back. We'll go to the slides for this. Okay, so a good summary of, so what does he think you will get to? Well, you'll get to three principles, which is really just two principles plus a third one, which doesn't add anything except saying there's nothing else. So what would we get to? What would be fair in the state of nature? What would everyone agree to? So this is what he thinks we'd agree to. Let's see. So there's three principles. There's the first principle, which is usually called justice in acquisitions. A person acquires a holding, and according to the principle of justice in acquisition, is entitled to that holding. So this is the minimal state is enforcing, you know, basic rules like don't kill each other, but also property rights. So this is essentially the role of the government, is to enforce these basic property rights. So he's thinking about when another way of saying that is he's thinking about when is inequality acceptable? Right? When is it fair for people to have differences in wealth? Right? So for Rawls, it was fair for people to have differences in wealth if those differences benefit the least advantaged. Right? So for Rawls, it was fair to have differences in wealth if those differences benefited the least advantaged. For Nozick, differences in wealth are okay as long as these two principles are not violated. As long as there's justice in acquisitions and justice in transfers, first principle, and again, it's a bit vague, but he says the person who acquires a holding, that's just some piece of property, according to the principle of justice and acquisition, is entitled, that means they have a right to that holding. And then this is a, what's that?
I don't get it. The person acquires a holding is entitled to it as long as...
That you own that. So what this means is, well, what's a principle of justice in acquisition? So that's a complicated topic, but we can take a simple example. Say you own some land, and you own that land fairly. If you grow some food on that land, you own that land, right? So say you grow a bunch of apples, you have a basket of apples. You are entitled to that holding. You have the property rights to those apples. Now, I don't have apples, and I might say, that's not fair. I want half your apples. Nozick would say, no, you don't get half the apples because, look, she got them fair and square, right? She had a right to the apples on her property. You don't have a right to the apples. Now, if I were to go to your property, pick your apples, I would not be entitled to those apples because I did not acquire them fairly. So that's acquisition. Now, what exactly it means to acquire something fairly is a little complicated, right? Which we'll get to, because what if I'm Native American and I say, my ancestors used to live on this land, so give me those apples. Now that becomes a problem, which we'll get to. But so justice and acquisition is complicated, but we can imagine simple cases of it. That just means if you get something fairly, you own it, you have a right to it.
So a person acquires a holding is entitled to it as long as they acquire it fairly.
Yeah, so that's what this justice in acquisition means. As long as acquisition means acquiring, fair is justice, right? So justice in acquisition. You own something if you've acquired it justly. So that's acquiring something sort of in the original sense, but there's other ways we acquire things, and that's essentially through transferring them. So the second principle is justice in transfers. A person who acquires a holding in accordance to the principle of justice in transfer from someone else entitled to that holding is entitled to that holding. So, say you have a basket of apples, and I have a deer that I killed, and I say on my property, although that could be complicated because deers don't usually just live on one piece of property, so is it fair for me to kill it just because it wandered onto my property? But say I grow something else, I grow potatoes, two baskets of potatoes, and I say, trade me your one basket of apples for two baskets of potatoes. You say, yes, you agree. Now, I had my potatoes fairly, you had your apples fairly, we traded them, and because we traded them fairly, we traded them without any coercion, I didn't put a gun to your head and say, give me your apples for my potatoes, you now have the right to my potatoes, and I have the right to your apples, right? So one way of thinking about this is, you can imagine attached to each piece of property is a little imaginary piece of paper that says, you know, so-and-so has a right to this, or so-and-so is the owner of this. And that's how we do cars, right? Or lands. It's called a deed. Who owns a car? Whoever's name is on the title owns the car. So, and then you sign that over. So we don't do that with potatoes and apples, but you can imagine, essentially, that with each piece of property, there's a title that goes along with it, and whoever has the title, they own that piece of property. So, what if I am really stupid and I decide to trade 100 baskets of potatoes for, like, one apple? I'm like, oh, I'll give you all my potato harvest that I grew on, you know, 100 acres or whatever, 10 acres, all my property, for one apple. And now I don't have anything to eat all winter. Well, if we agreed to the trade fairly, if you didn't coerce me or lie to me or anything, then Nozick would say, that's okay, right? So, this is about inequality, right? Inequality is okay if there's justice in acquisitions and there's justice in transfers. So it doesn't mean a trade literally has to be fair by an objective party, it just means we have to agree fairly. Under fair conditions, did we agree to switch properties? So inequality is fine, Nozick's going to say, as long as these conditions have been met. Justice in acquisitions, justice. So, so one way of thinking about Nozick's idea is, you know, you can imagine at time one, time two, right, there's a distribution of wealth. Like all the wealth in the world and all the items of property are owned by different people, right? So we go from time one to time two. There's been some transfer of goods and services. From time two to time three, there's been another transfer, right? In this little chunk of time, there's been transfers. Okay. And maybe at time one, you go all the way up here to time 10, and you can imagine, you know, at time one, you can imagine everyone starting off equally. You give everyone an equal amount of money or whatever. And over a period of years, people spend their money differently. They choose to spend their money differently. Some people invest it. Some people, you know, so in time one, maybe everyone has, you know, whatever, $100. At time 10, now one person has 1,000, maybe there's only 10 people, and 9 people have 0, right? Well, is it fair at time 10 that one person has $1,000 cash and the other 9 people have $0 cash? Nozick, he calls his conception of justice a historical conception. He says, well, we have to look at the history. So for Nozick, you can't just look at this to know whether this is fair or not. One way of doing it is looking purely at the distribution, right? But Nozick says that is the wrong approach. You don't look to determine whether inequality is fair. You don't look at the distribution. You look at the history. You look at how people got into that situation. So he is an example of, you know, well, some people are in jail and some people are not in jail. Is it fair that I'm in jail and you guys are not in jail? I had to spend last weekend in jail. None of you guys did, hopefully. Not did really, but. Would that be fair? Well, if I got caught driving drunk, then, you know, well, Moses would say this. To know whether it's fair that I had to spend the weekend in jail and none of you did, we have to know the history. Now, if I got caught drinking and driving and none of you did, then that would be fair. Now, if I got caught drinking and driving and someone else got caught drinking and driving and they didn't have to spend the night in jail and I did, that might be unfair. But if I'm the only one that did something wrong, then it makes sense for me to be in jail. So he calls that contrast, he calls his principle or conception of justice historical. So he says, an injustice can be worked or created by moving from one distribution to another structurally identical one. For the second, in the profile the same, may violate people's entitlements or deserts and may not actually fit the history. So he's against what he calls pattern distribution. Let us call a principle of distribution pattern if it specifies that a distribution is the very long subnatural dimension. philosophy lingo, but let us say distribution is patterned if it accords with some pattern principle. Like equality is a pattern distribution, everyone has the same. The point in this first quote is, you might have the same distribution. Let's imagine three people. One of them has $10, the other has $10, the other has zero. A, B, and C. A has zero, B and C have 10. Well, let's go to a different distribution. So that's two having 10, one having zero. C, or A steals C's $10. Now A and B have $10, C has zero. Now we have the same pattern, two with 10, one with zero, but it's a very different distribution. And it can be unjust if, even though it's the same distribution, if A stole the money from C. It would be just if A did something for C and C paid A $10. So basic point is that Nozick is making is distributions aren't the only thing that matter. History matters. And I think that's a fairly indisputable point that history does matter. Okay, so what's the problem with this theory? There's a basic reason why Nozick's theory isn't really taken too seriously as a philosophical theory, and he sort of acknowledges that it's incomplete as a philosophical theory. Okay, so he's got his two principles, justice and acquisitions, justice and transfers. Well, the obvious thing, and he says, look, as long as there's been no injustice in acquisitions and no injustice in transfer, then inequality is okay, right? Inequality is okay if there is justice in acquisitions and justice in transfer. Well, what if there's not justice in acquisition? And what if there's not justice in transfer, right? So it's not sort of a random accident that African-American people or Native Americans have drastically less wealth than white Americans, right? There is a historical facts that relate to those points. Slavery and, you know, taking Native American land, things like that. So what do we do about that? And that's, so you have to add a third principle in there, which is principle of rectification. So Nozick's theory is drastically incomplete without this principle. So he adds it in, and this does, in theory, solve a problem. It solves a problem of what do you do about when there isn't justice in acquisitions, when there isn't justice in transfers. He says, the existence of past injustice, previous violations of the first two principles, raises the third major topic under justice and holdings. Oh, sorry. The existence of past injustice raises the third major topic under justice and holdings, the rectification of injustice and holdings. If past injustice has shaped present holdings in various ways, some identifiable and some not, what now, if anything, ought to be done to rectify these injustices? What obligations do the performers of injustice have toward those whose position is worse than it would have been had injustice not been done, or worse than had compensation been paid promptly? So what do we do about past injustices, right? Now, if I want to make a trade, and I've got some potatoes, and I say, oh, I have these potatoes, I grew them, give me your apples, I'll give you my potatoes, but actually I stole them from someone else, and the person I stole them from comes along and says, hey, you stole my potatoes, that's pretty easy to solve, right? Okay, you get nothing, maybe you get punished, she gets her apples back, I get my potatoes back. But what if I already ate all the apples? So even like a very simple example of trading apples and potatoes, now she can't get her apples back. And now maybe we can give her new apples or whatever, but that's even a very simple situation. It's not easy to sort of go back and undo things, right? Or what if, she needed those apples to, or she was going to sell the potatoes to make enough money to pay her rent, then she needed to pay her rent, now she's homeless, or, like, so things can change very quickly, can be affected very quickly by a sort of injustice that had been occurred. Now, imagine something like slavery and segregation and various other things that have tap into certain populations or various populations. How do you go back and address those things? So what Nozick ends up doing is saying, well, he really, the funny thing is, he just kind of asked a bunch of questions. So what about if the direct party is the injustice or their descendants? You know, the direct parties are no longer alive. What do you do about that? Is injustice done to someone who's holding with itself based upon an unrectified injustice? How far back must one go in wiping clean the historical slate of injustices? What may victims of injustice permissibly do in order to rectify the injustices being done to them? Okay. So his conclusion, although it doesn't tell us much, but it tells us what we should do. And again, you have to sort of try and understand through the philosophy speak and technicality, but he says the principle of rectification will presumably make use of its best estimate of information about what would have occurred, or probability distribution of what might have occurred using expected value if the injustice had not taken place. So, using the example of, you know, African American and slavery and segregation, well, what do you do about, how do you rectify the injustice? Well, we have to go back and see what the distribution of wealth and income would be like in the United States if those things hadn't happened, and then you have to make the current distribution more like that one somehow. So, but then you also have to do the same thing for women and Native Americans and various other, you know, minority groups that have suffered along the way, and it starts to become very, very complicated, and it basically turns into a non-realistic proposal. So, essentially, that's why there might be some theoretical value to a historical conception of justice, but this rectification principle is so impossible to get any traction on that no one has really taken it too seriously. But that's a summary of Nozick's theory. Okay, we have 10 minutes. And what I want to do is, we don't have time to really talk about it. If we have more time next week, talk a little bit about it. There's something called universal basic income. I've mentioned it, so I'm gonna come back to this toward the end of the semester. But Milton Friedman, so we're gonna go back to Friedman for a minute. Milton Friedman, he actually proposed it back in the 1960s in his book Capitalism and Freedom. So universal basic income. This is the idea that, and one of the reasons why I think it's really interesting, one, I think it's a really great idea, I'm a fan, but I also think it's interesting from sort of what we're talking about is because libertarians are in favor of it and egalitarians are in favor of it, so that makes it interesting from a sort of philosophical perspective, and also practical, it's intriguing as a policy proposal. So universal basic income is the idea that everyone would get money from the government every month. So this is a serious idea. It was actually tried, and it was almost passed into law under Nixon in the 70s. A universal basic income was almost passed into law in the United States under the 70s. What happened was, I don't remember if it was the Senate or the House, they voted no against it because they wanted a larger basic income, and then never came back again around for various reasons. So there was a fairly long-running experiment in Canada called guaranteed minimum income. So the idea is that the government, kind of like Social Security, the government would just give a check to everyone in the mail per month. So I could explain it, but there's usually some basic questions people have. So what comes to mind? So would people stop working? That's one common objection or concern. Studies have shown that people don't stop working. So usually, say it's $1,000 a month. That might sound like a lot to you, But it's unlikely that any of you, if you were given $1,000 a month for the rest of your life, would stop working. Mm-hmm. What you'd do is be like, oh, this is great. Now I can earn more money because, you know, most people want to earn $50,000 or $60,000 or $100,000 a year, right, or more, and you'd have the potential to do that. So you find that people don't stop working. What they tend to do is, and if they do, they usually only do it to go to school or things like that. So, for example, the experiment in Canada, the only group that showed declines in working were mothers with young children. Those are the only people that showed a significant decline in the amount of time working. All other groups didn't work less. And you might think that that's actually a good result because we do want children being taken care of properly. So it's not necessarily a bad thing. So in general, the answer, and this is not just me sort of, this is evidence from a lot of different studies. And there's actually a lot of programs, especially in developing countries. There's a lot of, there's a movement in terms of giving in Africa to shift away from giving people food and things like that to just giving them cash. And that's actually one of the reasons why Milton Friedman likes it. As an economist, he's all about economic efficiency, right? So to give people food is really hard, right? What do you have to do to give people food? What do you need?
Money.
Well, you need money, but then what do? So you get some money, then you do what?
Buy food.
You buy food, then what do? So if I'm here in America and I want to give food to people in Africa, what do I have to do? I buy some corn.
Mail it.
I ship it across the sea, then what do I need? People in Africa to take care of the food, and trucks to move the food, and all kinds of stuff. So you end up, and you need a whole organization to manage this. You end up losing a lot of the money on things that don't go to the people who need it. Whereas, if I want to give money to someone in Africa, I can just do that by pressing a button on a computer and put some money in their bank account. So, and people who are given money, they don't work less, and they tend to be doing much better. So you can track. Say I give someone $100 versus giving them. Some aid organizations give people chickens, sometimes give them food. There's different things you can give people, and you can see how well those families are doing. And just giving people money affects people the best years down the road. Okay, so what other possible objections? Would people stop working? Answer tends to be no from all the studies that have been done, and there's actually currently a number of studies being done worldwide.
Why don't we do this? I want $1,000.
Other possible objections. You guys got them. Everyone has the same basic questions when you first hear about the idea.
Who's going to pay for it?
Who's going to pay for it? So, the key thing to understand is the government already spends a lot of money. So, related to this is, would it cause inflation, right? Anyone think about that? A lot of people think, well, would it cause inflation if you're just giving people money? The answer is no. I mean, it could cause inflation if you just printed the money, but the basic idea is the government is already, U.S. government budget, the government would pay for it, right? So, here's how much money we spend. Government, 72.9, like, education, $70 billion, Medicare and health, $66 billion, veterans benefits, $65 billion, military, $600 billion, food and agriculture, transportation, social security, unemployment, blah, 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 science, energy, and the environment, international affairs. So it's really just a matter of taking some of this money and changing how we spend it. Now, obviously, a lot of it is going to come from this big blue chunk over here. But the key thing is the size of this pie isn't fixed. So there's basically two ways how you pay for it. One is changing how we currently spend money. So you change some of these numbers around. And you'd be able to save some money in terms of, you'd be able to cut some government services. So you'd be able to cut various government services, like housing, for example. Housing and community could be cut by quite a lot, because if you're giving everyone $1,000 a month, you wouldn't necessarily need that. Military could obviously be cut a lot and spend as much as the rest of the world combined. But the key, so you can cut some on healthcare. Gets a little technical, but so we pay for it by cutting some expenses we're currently doing, shifting some things around, and also of course by raising taxes on the super wealthy, like same way you pay for anything. And that's really any government program, how do you pay for it? Comes down to raising taxes. Well, who are you going to raise taxes on? The only people that have money. Who has money? Top half of society, but really it's the top 10%, top 20%, top 1% essentially. So there's a lot of different tax proposals. Other questions? Common one is would people just spend their money on drugs or alcohol? Studies have shown that's not true as well. And we could talk about that, but I think that notion is a very sort of pessimistic view of human nature, and it misunderstands the nature of drug and alcohol abuse, because people do that when they feel hopeless, not when they feel empowered. When you give someone $1,000 a month, they're going to feel empowered, not hopeless. That's why the recent opioid epidemic has taken off since the recession, right? There was an opioid epidemic when the economy was doing well. There was an opioid epidemic when the economy crashed. People felt like they had no control over their lives. That's a sort of an interesting topic in and of itself, but there's been no evidence that it would lead to increased drug and alcohol abuse. People that are given money, poor people, tend to save it or spend it very wisely. Anyhow, we'll come back to this topic because I think it's a really important one. Maybe we'll watch a video on it. But I just want to say, it's just to bring it back to the topic at hand. Libertarians tend to be, so going back to this idea of the way Milton Friedman thinks about eliminating poverty, he considers eliminating poverty a public good, right? So, Milton Friedman thinks we can use the government to accomplish things that are impossible or inefficient to accomplish on our own. So he doesn't think we have a moral obligation to help people that are poor, but he says, look, poverty is bad for everyone. It's a public good to get rid of it. It's not that anyone has a right to not be poor, but it's bad for everyone if there is poverty. Poverty leads to crime and things like that. So we should get rid of poverty, and he actually suggests a minimum basic income. Egalitarians, of course, think that poverty should be gotten rid of because people have a right to not live in poverty. So that's one of thinking about the differences to bring it back on. All right. I will not see you guys Wednesday. No class. And we'll see you Monday.